Thanks to all of you for sticking with it to the, I hope not so bitter end. So I'm going to talk about deconstructing the barrier of meaning. This is an idea that's been with me for a long time. So this is a copy of Giancarlo Rocha's kind of collected thoughts, indiscrete thoughts, which I purchased in 2003 when I was doing a post-bac summer at Los Alamos. Chris Wood actually gave me a spot award for essentially being like a good sport about moving offices four times. And so I went to the, at the time, very small and now non-existent bookstore in Los Alamos, picked this book up. And as I was telling Melanie yesterday, I have read this barrier of meaning essay, I mean, at least 20 times, because this is one of these books that tends to sit by my bedside table and I read when I have a hard time sleeping. And I finally think I have some idea of what he's talking about, which I will get to at the end. So broadly speaking, I want to bring us back to thinking about meaning. And I'm reading this term barrier of meaning to be essentially whatever is keeping AI from understanding, creating, or thinking in a human-like way. And this being SFI, I thought as the sort of organizing shtick, I build off of this idea of an eightfold way. So we're going to have eight principles to work off of in terms of how we might be able to pull this barrier of meaning down. And I'm going to start with the notion of right experience. Is the way that we're approaching the task of training AI models of various kinds, giving them the right experience to have human-like meaning, understanding, and so forth. And of course, I don't need to tell most of you about benchmarking, the idea of abstracting a real-world problem into a task, building or finding a data set to represent it, defining some performance metric, and then comparing algorithms to each other on this benchmark. All of you have seen many, many of these tables. You have a bunch of algorithms, a bunch of scores. The one in bold is, of course, the one created by the authors of the paper. And what we were really interested in studying was the distribution of attention across different benchmark data sets. And so we had a paper in NeurIPS a couple of years ago with my student Bernie Koch and a couple of collaborators, Emily Denton and Alex Hanna at the time, both at Google AI Ethics. And basically, I'm just going to tell you what we found using a corpus coming from Papers with Code. Looking over, this will be archaeological since we started in 2015 and went up to 2020. But what we found was that over that now ancient historical period, tasks became more concentrated on fewer data sets over time. This is true even if you control for all sorts of things you might think would affect task concentration. And this is true for both ML as a whole, as well as a number of sub areas, computer vision, methods. NLP, for interesting reasons, is the only one that has sort of resisted this trend. We were also interested in the degree to which tasks, that is, you know, some problem like image segmentation, creates more unique data sets than they import. And it turns out they do. Tasks are creating data sets to be used for those fine-grained tasks, but there's a big difference between what you create and what you use. And if you look at what you use, most tasks are using imported data sets more than the created ones. So in other words, they're taking things from outside, borrowing those, and using them instead. And again, you'll probably be unsurprised to hear that 12 organizations, many of you are affiliated with some of them, have been responsible for more than 50% of data set usages. So to be very clear, data set reuse is essential to the practice of benchmarking. It's essential to the practice of comparison and measurement. But in terms of things like AI understanding, the selective environment, to use the term that has come up earlier in the day, that these models are being exposed to, excess concentration can cause epistemic distortion. It can lead to social harms. It can lead to waste as the benchmarks are drifting from real-world tasks and the architectures come to fit or overfit popular benchmarks. Those benchmarks often reflect narrow and, surprise, surprise, often corporate goals. Making good benchmarks is very expensive. And so if we want creation of benchmarks by diverse individuals and diverse institutions, which for standpoint epistemological reasons we should, that activity needs to be financially supported. And of course, researchers should be incentivized to use appropriate rather than merely popular benchmarks. We actually advocate, much like the sort of ethical analysis that you are now required to do in a lot of AIML conferences, you should now have to account for why you chose to use particular benchmark data sets. And for all of you, you should think about creating new benchmarks. I know many of you are involved with doing that, like Big Bench, that's awesome. And then of course, remind your students and those who work with you not just to use the popular benchmarks, but to justify the selection, consider using multiple benchmarks and support multi-metric evaluation. But this is a less important point. The more important point is that the real world is not divided into tasks. Most tasks are created by organisms based on their environment and their internal state. This is one that I'm very familiar with as an example of a task being created by an organism that has never confronted this task before and, well, often confronts it now, but in any case. The exceptions where learning systems are given tasks to solve involve power disparity, where one party is determining the game and the objective function. So the lab or the factory floor is very different from the world in which real humans typically operate. So the first deconstructive principle is that we need to understand how and how often tasks are created by organisms in naturalistic behavior. Thinking about creating benchmarks for that kind of autonomous task creation, and remembering that interacting with powerful AI actors, as folks have mentioned in the past, can deform our goals and our meanings. So that's thing one. Thing two has to do with how we're thinking about culture. And in doing that, I want to riff off of a paper I wrote a few years ago called Culture and Computation. Now, culture is an essential part of the human experience. I'm pleased to hear how often it has come up, especially today. It shapes our cognition, it structures our societies, and of course, human-compatible AI needs to be able to interface with and understand human culture in order to be human-compatible. But what is culture? I'm sure many of you know there was an attempt in 1952 to gather definitions, which came up with 164 distinct answers. I don't want to talk about what the contents of culture are, the way some sociologists might, saying their beliefs, values, norms, institutions, practices, etc. I want to focus on formal properties of culture to use a kind of computational thinking lens. And so my definition is to say when we talk about culture, we're talking about any shared regularity in the organization of experience or the generation of action that's acquired through social life. And in terms of thinking more deeply about the ontology and the way in which culture circulates, I follow very closely the point of view developed by the cognitive anthropologist Dan Sperber, who has really pushed us to think less about cultural things and more about these cognitive causal chains, sequences of cognitive processes that are linked to one another that can move between people through what he calls public representations, making this distinction between what's out there in the world and what's in people's heads, and then some subset of those social cognitive causal chains circulate broadly enough that we think of them as culture. So cultural cognitive causal chains are ones that sort of move sufficiently broadly. They're sufficiently common in a population. Keeping in mind the fact that culture changes as it circulates, Celeste showed us yesterday, my concept of dog is going to be different from your concept of dog, but it's important that we be able to recognize them in some sense as tokens of some kind of similar type. And of course, it's also important to recognize that while this picture of a CCC shows speech, of course, public representations can be very durable, they can move all over the place, they don't have to be these ephemeral vibrations in air, so you can think about books and monuments and signs and radio and televisions and movies and blogs, etc. That's all public representation. So from this point of view, the explanandum of thinking about culture really should be trying to understand the distribution and the characteristics of these cultural chains, which ones tend to spread widely, which tends to co-occur. And I think this is actually a major limitation, but much as I am a big fan of the Boyd and Richardson and later Henrik point of view, I don't think they have, because the Sperber approach places much more focus on the detailed mechanics of transmission and on the role of both cognition and other existing representations in the cultural process, I think it's much better equipped to kind of give a more detailed account of what culture is. This Spurgeonian framework has all sorts of virtues. It can, for example, in a very easy way, talk both about something like prestige biased transmission, in which you direct attention to the kind of culture produced by high prestige individuals, remembering that what makes someone high prestige is also defined by a mental representation, or the way that information transforms as it is circulated, as it isn't just imitated but learned, to be consistent with other cultural models. And many of you know, I'm sure, the classic Bartlett War of the Ghosts experiment, where English research subjects were exposed to a Native American story about ghosts. And then as that chain is transmitted, it comes to be recounted with the sort of Native American ghost elements replaced with English ghost story elements. Sorry, Bonnie.
She does not like the ghost.
Another major debate that goes on in sociological audiences about culture is the nature of its degree of coherence as a kind of package, or its kind of grab bag-like nature. And these debates are entirely dissolvable once you take a perspective that says you actually need to talk about how cultural learning happens, how it is that culture moves from one person to another. And in this 2018 paper, using a very, very simple computational theory level model, you can see already that this question dissolves completely. As you're acquiring ways to perceive, label, and act on the material and social and symbolic environment, if you have consistent streams of experience, you will learn coherent culture encoded in narrow, tightly coupled, densely layered systems of programs. This is a position associated with, for example, Pierre Bourdieu. If you have inconsistent streams of experience, that leads to a more loose culture encoded in loosely coupled, potentially contradictory, situation-dependent, and idiosyncratic culture. This is a position associated with the Berkeley sociologist Ian Swidler. Another debate that you can just put to one side is this issue of the degree to which culture is out there, embedded in the world, or embodied inside us. And this is a sort of major axis of debate in theories of culture over many decades. I think the best way to think of this is sort of ecological in the sense of ecological rationality. Culture guides our action as embodied cultural things encounter decipherable cultural handles in the environment, in artifacts. These are the products of earlier culturally mediated action. So the story David told us, in which David Krakauer, there are so many Davids here, David Krakauer told us, in which artifacts play a critical role, involves a kind of fit, an ontological complicity, to use a bit of jargon that Bourdieu introduced, between artifacts, culture out there in the world, and certain kinds of embodied cultural dispositions that enable us to use those artifacts effectively. So this Swidlerian question, the biggest unanswered question when we think about culture, is whether and how some cultural elements control, anchor, or organize others. Basically, there's plenty of evidence, which I don't have time to show you, but now we know that yes, of course, cultural elements control, anchor, and organize others. We're starting to have a better understanding of how that happens. In 2023, we need to ask questions like how these cultural elements come to interact in AI systems. Do LLMs have a coherent or incoherent culture? I would say almost certainly incoherent is a function of the way that they've been trained and the kinds of experiences that they've had, which have not been focused and structured in particular ways. Is that desirable? It's an interesting question. So the second deconstruction coming from this, I have 15 minutes left, is that right? Okay, is that meaning and culture are inextricable. We shouldn't treat traces of human culture as a kind of slurry to just feed into the LLM. We need, if we're gonna think about how to crash the barrier of meaning, that requires understanding how culture is structured and how it works in minds and bodies and artifacts. So in other words, I'm making a pitch for all of you to think more about what a computational account of culture might look like. Point three is what the right model of the human should be. Many of you, I'm sure, have seen the like Shoggoth interpretation of large language models and this idea. We've had this debate of agent versus cacophony. I especially like the way Ida described it, LLMs as being a cacophony based on billions of past human minds. I'm attracted to that kind of necromantic definition. And where, the only place that I sort of part with that is saying that because of culture, that's kind of true of humans as well. In other words, like LLMs, in some ways, we're channeling that cacophony in order to achieve very different goals, following on Rose's point from this morning, next token prediction. In one case, all the things we use culture to do in our human social lives in the other case. And so it's not literally the ghosts of past human minds that are filling up our heads. This is another iteration of Dan Dennett's point from this morning, but their traces, the cultural organism they have produced and circulated. And just to give you a very quick example of why it makes sense to think about cultural things as cultural organisms that sort of occupy our heads, I will tell you very quickly about some empirical work we did looking at cultural change from an evolutionary perspective in a interesting context. That context is metal music. So it also allows me to acknowledge our anonymous informant Hellblazer. This was a paper Ernie and I wrote with a wonderful computational macroevolutionary biologist named Daniele Silvestro. And what we do in this paper is try to understand the evolutionary dynamics of bands, which we view as sort of embodied ideas, as well as genres from a perspective of birth-death processes. And so I'm not going to give you any of the details, but basically the question is, how can we model the drivers of the dynamics we see in the diversity of bands and the diversity of genres, so on and so forth, with the underlying principle that what bands are competing for are literally space in people's heads. And the punchline of this story is that you can actually come up with a pretty good account of those dynamics, combining a competition process where we actually had to like improve some of the macroevolutionary competition models in order to make them work the way that they're supposed to, where as the carrying capacity is filled, birth and death rates should converge. So here, the blue lines, or whatever sort of blue lines, are the solid lines are model predictions of birth rates. The dotted lines are the empirical data. Of course, this is not like a perfect fit, but it actually does a really good job with a quite small number of parameters. And the key thing is that competition is relaxed over the history of this particular genre by innovation. Innovation relaxes that competition by expanding carrying capacity. It does so by introducing new genres, new distinct ways that someone can be a metal band. And so if you look at the way in which new, and my apologies to anyone who is an actual metalhead here because I do not know any of the deep details of this material, but the major categories like death or thrash or heavy or black metal, those come online at various points in time. They're introduced as new niches. Within each of those niches, sub-genres are introduced, new bands appear and fill up the niche, and we're actually sort of beautifully fit the way in which carrying capacity expands as a function of those introductions of new niches and the predictions of our model. So from this perspective, human brains and human artifacts provide the environment in which these cultural forms live. David Krakauer had a very beautiful way of putting this in a discussion we had about a year ago, where he described a vast forest of brain trees in which the cultural forms live for at least part of their cycle, because of course they also live in artifacts, as David pointed out this morning. I have to apologize to David because I'm not a Freudian, but more of a Jungian. And I think from that perspective, Carl Jung put his finger on a really interesting and important way of thinking about how cultural forms work. He called them autonomous complexes that sort of feed on time and attention. My friends and collaborators Phil Ford and J.F. Martel have this beautiful term, luminous parasite, to refer to them. And so then this leads to the third deconstruction. To what extent, this has come up several times, I think we need to think about it seriously, is the human mind a mask worn by a cacophony of processes, including countless cultural forms? And we've heard John gave us some examples in his talk of competition between different processes for control. And so when and why do these processes collaborate to serve an organism? And how does agency emerge from agents? Right creativity. So this is number four. I think I just have enough time to get through all of these because these next ones are shorter. Creativity has come up several times, and I think it's essential that we keep creativity at the center of our thinking about human intelligence and human collective intelligence. The metal example I showed you highlights the multi-scale nature of this collective creativity. It's something that occurs from actors within bands, within genres, within broader communities of listeners and producers. And this has already been alluded to in the discussion that was kicked off in Allison's talk, different modes of creativity. The cognitive scientist Margaret Boden distinguishes between a kind of tinkering mode of making something new, a recombinatory mode, and then a sort of transformational mode where you're kind of changing the whole game in which you're playing this particular creative exercise. Incidentally, these three distinctions very closely map on to a broader picture that James Evans and I with Bill Shee came up with for kind of categorizing different ways we think about measuring and modeling novelty. I'll also just mention, because evolutionary aspects have been an important part of this meeting and distinctions about what non-human animals can and cannot do, I wrote a paper a couple of years ago with colleagues who are mostly animal cognition researchers on the role of invention in cultural evolution. And I have to tell you, our understanding of invention, like the ability to creatively recombine behaviors, solve novel tasks in creative ways, is shockingly limited. And much of that has to do with profound methodological limitations of the kind that Erica mentioned yesterday. It's also the case, as several folks noted yesterday, that models of invention, informal models of cultural evolution, are much too limited. There are a handful of cases where cultural evolutionary models coupled to, say, population dynamics or whatever involve anything richer than like a linear, you know, the tinkering mode of like, I can make this one thing better in a cumulative fashion. Since Blaise brought up the role of culture in invention and collective computation yesterday, I want to note that culture facilitates collective computation, for example, in the scientific community. This is something, of course, James has done a lot of work on, including me. I have a talk in the 2019 Metascience Symposium if you want to hear more about that. But in the interest of getting through my eightfold way, fourth deconstruction. Creativity is at the heart of human intelligence, but we have no good data about its evolution and a poor understanding about its role in models of cultural evolution. So I think we need to make creativity more central to the study of natural and artificial intelligences. Now I want to talk next about language. It's not the linguistic code, or at least I would say, if we start by thinking about the linguistic code, we're starting in the wrong place. I was so pleased to hear people bringing up, again, Dan Sperber's work, my good friend Tom Scott Phillips, arguing that the base layer of human communicative capacity is this joint ability for extension and inference that is then turbocharged by the linguistic code. But the foundation is this ability to, on the one hand, signal signalhood, that's what extension means. A great example that Erica and I used in a paper a few years ago was when we were cleaning up for a holiday party, and to indicate to someone that they needed to participate, one of us tugged on tablecloth so that a glass in front of them shook just a little bit, indicating that they needed to do something about it. So this is an example of, has anyone ever used that particular thing to signal that particular action? Probably not. Was it immediately legible? Definitely. And that brings us to the inferential side of the story, that we take all of this evidence from a communicative act, including the linguistic code, but including much, much more, in order to make inferences about what is being communicated by our counterparty. And one of the points that I think is underappreciated about the OI picture is that under that account, the same act, like tipping your hat to someone, can mean precisely opposite things. In the first case, a friendly greeting. In the second case, that person looks extremely threatening to me. That's like the kind of way you tip your hat to someone where you're going to murder them later. And so I think the important thing to keep in mind is that ostension and inference actually make the space of possible communicative meanings infinite. And then that needs to be managed. It needs to be carved down. How is it that we use various semiotic resources to whittle down a space of possible meanings? And Eric and I wrote a paper a few years ago, an ephestra for our dear and deceased colleague, Chuck Goodwin, looking in a sort of analytic way at the ways in which physical form, physical context, joint activity, shared history, and linguistic code can all narrow down meaning. And Celeste actually gave us a great example yesterday of the way in which physical context, joint activity, and shared history can play a role. If you recall the orange squeeze, I always had a hard time retrieving the word, the orange squeezer example, that was a situation where physical context, deixis, joint activity that the people were participating in, and some shared history narrowed down the space of possible meanings and made it very trivial to solve. I would encourage any of you who have not read Chuck's work to engage with it. He really is a totally brilliant thinker that changed the way that I think about language and communication entirely. And one example I would especially commend to all of you who are thinking about language and communication is Chuck's work with his father, Chill, who suffered a devastating stroke, which made him almost entirely productively aphasic. So he could say yes, no, and that's it. But receptively, his comprehension was outstanding. And Chuck gives some amazing examples in the way in which, with these incredibly impoverished productive resources, he's able to work with context, work with the language being produced to others to communicate very complicated meanings and intentions. And so this fifth deconstruction, if the OI account is right, then training on written language, I think, gets communication backwards. Rose's argument on goals this morning speaks to this entirely. To my perspective, the magic isn't in the linguistic code, but in ostension and inference, made much more powerful by language. Creativity is really at the center of communication. Semiotic resources are then tools that play a function in some context. But the phylogenetic distribution of ostension and inference is very poorly understood. Erica has done some great work thinking about why, again, for methodological reasons, the claims that folks like Tom make about animal, non-human animals versus human communicative systems are deeply corrupted by the kind of evidence. Okay, in the interest of getting to Giancarlo Rota, I will just tell you stories. This was one of Blaise's missing ingredients from LLMs. They're very important. I think they're very important because they fill a role between habit and between sort of declarative, deliberative, or sorry, between habitual and deliberative behavior, and that they provide essentially highly compressed, sort of like artifactual versions of behavioral scripts, guides to thinking about some situation. And so again, I don't have time to tell you this whole story, but you can actually think about stories in a very similar way to the way Gershman and Daw think about memories and epistemic reinforcement, or sorry, episodic reinforcement learning. And that gets you a very nice account of the way stories work as pieces of culture. So language allows people to share highly compressed partial models. This isn't like instruction or declarative knowledge of a kind of linguistic equivalent of the artifacts in the Searle inversion. Okay, so wrapping things up, these 7 and 8 are gonna move right into each other. What's the right way to think about meaning? I mentioned to you, I have spent a ton of time reading this, like, how many of you have read, by the way, the original Barrier of Meaning? Very cryptic, I think. Very cryptic, on brand for Stan Ulam, who's the main sort of protagonist in this story. I don't know why. Oh, he's coming up there. There he is. And this essay gives an account of a discussion that Ulam had with the mathematician slash philosopher Giancarlo Rota about the AI problem. And one of the points that Ulam makes is that there's a fundamental misunderstanding that he viewed as going on in AI research having to do with what it is when intelligent perception occurs. And so he says, you always perceive a function, never an object in the set theoretic or physical sense. And he gives some examples of like when you see a key, part of what it means, what the key means, has to do with understanding the function of keys in some context. When you see a passenger in a car, how is it that you see them as a passenger? And so he talks about this. Logic formalizes only very few of the processes by which we think. The time has come to enrich formal logic by adding some other fundamental notions to it. What is it that you see when you see? You see an object as a key, you see a man in the car as a passenger, you see some sheets of paper as a book. It's the word as that must be mathematically formalized on par with connectives and or implies and not that have already been accepted into formal logic. Until you do that, you will not get far with your AI problem. Now, if you're like me, at this point, you're still a bit unclear about what on earth he's talking about. And fortunately, like 2 days ago, as I obviously brought this along with me and was reading it in bed as I'm wont to do, I decided to read a later essay on Fundierung as a logical concept. And I have to apologize to anyone who is an expert on Husserl. I am not, but I'm gonna give my best to account, to give Rota's account. So he makes the distinction between the sort of ground, the facticity, like using an example from Gilbert Ryle, he talks about like the physical card that is the Queen of Hearts versus its function in some context, like in a game of bridge. And the relationship that holds between that factical thing, the card, and its function as a trump in a bridge game or whatever, is this notion of Fundierung or founding. That's the relation in which we see the card as that function or that meaning. And he says, content matters more than text, yet content exists less than text. You might gloss it as meaning matters more than facticity, yet meaning exists less than the facticity, in the sense that like, we're talking with meaning about these sort of informational, imaginative things. We need to formalize this as relation to see the key, the middle hunk as a key, to see the card in a context as a trump. And this immediately leads to the last theme, that meaning is about imagination. It's about seeing what is as what could be. And so imagination is the last part of the story. This is this famous figure, an engraving by Flammarion of someone kind of reaching out of the contained sphere into the heavens. And I want to view that as the barrier of meaning that separates the factical from the function, the actual from the possible, or the imaginal, to use a term that I like very much, that the French scholar of religion, and specifically Islam and Islamic mysticism, Henri Corbin, coined. And I think right experience, right culture, right model, right creativity, right language, right story, right meaning, all boil down to this: the human ability to access this space of the imagination, some subset of which is what we call understanding, because of the relationship between that part of the space of the possible and the actual physical world, which has been expanding because of our capacity to remake the actual to look like the imaginal. How did this happen? Here's one possible story. emergent accidental entry to the imaginal, which may have happened many times, finally ran into some subset that constitutes a very little form of understanding. And again, I started thinking about this in part because of the exchange that happened around some of Blaise's remarks, that some of this kind of stuff might be happening in an emergent way in LLMs. So we, by chance, to bastardize Burroughs, cut into the imaginal and understanding started to leak out. Natural selection seized on that cut and expanded it. And now this is one of the core functions of our brain, to access and manipulate this world of possibility, particularly that part we call understanding, where culture and stories and language all help us to see the world as the same thing, so we can work together, and creativity helps us explore the imaginal. Do we want AI to crash that barrier of meaning? I think some of you are definitely on board with that. I am not so sure. So I want to thank the funders and just say, you know, if you can make it and you've loved the kind of conversations that we've been having here, I am organizing with Josh Tenenbaum and a bunch of other folks a meeting, not this fall, but next fall, at the Institute for Empirical and Applied Mathematics on the mathematics of intelligences, which you would all be perfect for. So be on the lookout for that. Thank you all so much, and sorry for